Hi, did you convert van? Yes, I did. Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to do something a little bit different, and that is answering, replying, responding to some of the many questions I've had about my van build. After all, it's time for another video. Since I started releasing my van build videos, I've received over 1,000 comments. I do try to respond to the comments on my videos, but I don't always get the time for it, so I thought I'd address them here. So let's get started with the insulation. First up, hi, was the van much quieter after doing this? Yes, but it's only a small van and I never really got the panel boom you'd get with the sprinter vans, the much larger vans, but the insulation definitely dampens the sound a bit. I noticed it, especially in the doors, once they were filled with the recycled plastic bottle insulation, they had quite a nice thud to them as opposed to being tinny. So yeah, definitely an improvement there. Couldn't you use expanding foam in the doors? Quite possibly. There are definitely some industrial methods for spray foaming the entirety of a van, and I'm sure it gives incredible insulation properties, but I think for these doors it would have been very messy, and as you mentioned in the comments, you'd have to be careful with the door mechanism as well. I wouldn't want to completely fill that in, but I've been very happy with the mixture of foil bubble wrap and recycled plastic bottle insulation I put in the doors here. Can you tell me why you didn't cover the roof beams with silver foil? Yeah, absolutely. There's a really good reason for this. I used expanding foam in the roof beams and then carpeted over them. Before I'd insulated, I'd slept in the van a number of times, had some really damp mornings as well, where lots of the van inside was condensated on the bare metal, and those bits simply weren't condensated. So I didn't see any need to put any silver foil on them. Once the expanding foam was in there, that would be adequate. The carpet over the top does a brilliant job, and there's no condensation on them now. Hi, awesome. Is that me or the van conversion? Where did you source your reflective insulation and carpet, and what types are these, please? So I've already mentioned them briefly, but there's foil bubble wrap insulation, the recycled plastic bottle insulation, and four-way stretch automotive carpet. The color of the carpet is smoke gray. The brand of the foil insulation is Thermowrap, though there are lots of others which would do an equally good job, I'm sure. And the recycled plastic bottle insulation is from Deal, which is a B&Q brand. Okay, now on to carpeting the van. What is your wall covering, felt? It's the four-way stretch automotive carpet in smoke gray. It's available widely online, but it does look a lot more like felt than it does carpet. Very stretchy, really easy to work with, and great for getting around all the contours of the van. So is there a reason you chose carpet? Does it help with insulation and sound noise? And also, can you tell me why you use carpet rather than ply? So for the first question, carpet really helps with both. It helps with insulation and sound deadening to an extent. It's not the best insulator, but it definitely reduces some condensation. So to answer the first and second question there, wood can be quite heavy. So depending on the thickness of ply you use, it can add some weight and fuel cost to your van there. I really like how it looks just personally around the contours of the van. It's quite soft to touch as well. It also hides marks and saves you a bit of space as well by carpeting, because you don't cover up all the contours and the cavities with the ply. Can you tell me how much carpet you used and how many square meters of carpet were used in the van? It was about 5 meters for the walls altogether, 2.5 for each side, not including the doors. And I used an extra 4 meters, about a meter per door. They didn't have to be quite as long, so that was 1.4 meters to get from the top of the door to the bottom of the door, whereas I needed 2 meter bits to get from the ceiling down to the floor when doing the walls of the van. In total, I spent about £75 on the carpet. You had any dramas with condensation carpeting directly onto the metal? No, I haven't had any issues. The glue's holding strong. There's no condensation to speak of. Nothing's peeling off or anything. So the carpet's definitely been a benefit to the van in terms of waking up in the morning and finding the wall soaking wet. Well, that doesn't happen anymore. Is it possible to remove the carpets if you want to sell your camper van as a van in the future? Possibly. It would be a huge amount of effort and a lot of solvent to get rid of the glue as well. I think the carpet would probably rip off if you put a bit of elbow grease in, but yeah, the glue would be a nightmare to get off. And it was one of the things I had to really commit to with the van as being a permanent feature, and just realizing that I wasn't going to take it off, and that if I carpeted it, that would be it. And I'm really pleased I did it. So next up is the ceiling. There's not too many comments on that, but this one is, how did you attach the ceiling? And I did do a video on this where you can see it in full, but I used very small metal screws to go through the very thin ply. So it's a very light ceiling, and they just go into a little ridge on the roof beams. I had to take them down a couple of times to insulate under, to varnish the boards, and then they always go back up, no problem. So yeah, really happy with that solution. Now, everyone wants to know about how the rubber seals on my carpeted doors are holding up. So the rubber is holding up really well. I made one change and that was to the back doors. The inside door handle was knocking the rubber a little bit, so I peeled that off. And instead of using the silicone adhesive, I used a super glue just to test it out. And it worked really well. I'll pop a link to that in the description as an alternative option to the silicone adhesive, which was quite messy and took quite a long time. What if the door latch fails? And I assume that's because I carpeted over the doors and over the insulation over the door cavity. So that's a good question, but I mean, I would just cut through the carpet, cut through the insulation, make an incision. It's all covered by the door card. And then I'd fix or replace whatever needed to be done there. And then it would be a case of patching it back up, putting the door card on, and you'd never know I was in there. So I don't think it's a real problem. It's quite easy to access still. Just wondering why you didn't cut some ply panels, carpet them and attach them to the doors. And why did you choose this method over a ply door card? I'm sure it would have looked neat, carpeting some ply, attaching it to the walls, to the doors. But I wanted to give myself a challenge. I really like the look of the rubber edge, and it also creates a rubber seal to keep water out. The water just drips down the rubber edge and away from the carpet. Also, the ply would have been directly screwed into the doors, and I wanted to minimize as much as possible the amount I was screwing into the metal of the fan. That can promote rust, especially on a door which is open, can be exposed to the rain. So I carpeted around the contours of the door, did the rubber seal, and been really happy with it. Next is the three section pull-out bench bed, and a lot of people wanted to know the dimensions on this. So the bed is 183 centimeters long. There's a little bit of space at the top and the bottom if you wanted to extend it a bit further, but that's pretty much adequate for someone about 6 foot and under. And in terms of width, it's 56 centimeters when closed, and when the three sections are pulled out, it's 150 centimeters, which is equivalent to a king size bed. And that brings me nicely on to the next question. How do you find the NV for sleeping space-wise with the two of you? Really good. A king size bed is just lovely. It's very comfy, the mattresses are great, and yeah, we have a great time camping, very comfortable night's sleep. Do you remember how long it took you to build? So I made the bed in two stages. The first was to do the frame and the legs, that's not including the drawer, and the second was to do the slats and work out how they'd move over each other with the three sections. Overall, I think it was about 2 days work, but that doesn't include the planning. I spent ages thinking about the bed. I hadn't seen a three section pull-out bed before, so I had no idea how it would work, but eventually it worked. And yeah, about 2 days spent building the actual bed. Just buy a basic sofa bed from IKEA, done. It's not quite as easy as that for the NV200. Maybe for a bigger van, you could just buy a standard bed, attach it, and you're done. As I said earlier, I had special requirements for the bed in the van. I needed to access the center so I could fit my surfboard in, but also there are angles at the back of the NV200. And if you want a full length bed, you've got to factor in those. So a rectangle bed just wouldn't have fitted in, unfortunately. Next is the floor, and specifically the fuel pump access. I've had no problems with the floor, but people have raised the question of the fuel pump access. On the NV200, it's just about here, and I just laid the floor. And I know a lot of other people have as well. They've just put the floor down. I've never needed to access a fuel pump, and I believe you can do it from underneath. They don't quote me on that. So if there was a problem, it could be accessed. Also, I've kept the floor removable. It's not screwed in, and all my furniture is removable. So for a few extra minutes, I haven't had to put a little hatch in the floor. Also, this is my main access to the van, and I'm sure after a while, the edge would degrade. It would pick up dirt. Next up are the window covers, and these have created quite a bit of debate about how they're used. I can just say now that I use mine as a way to reflect the sun out in the summer, so to keep the van cool, but also to just to try and reduce a bit of the condensation when we're staying in the van at night. I don't have a heater, I don't have ventilation, I'll go on to that in a minute. So these were just a way to block the windows so people can't see in and to try and reduce a bit of condensation overnight. So painting the silver side black might be stealth, but that's not really what I'm going for. We normally camp at campsites anyway, but if that's what you're looking for, then great. Have you used these blinds in winter yet? I'm interested to know if you think they can keep the cold out, the warm in. And isn't it better if the thermal layer is on the inside so body heat can bounce on it rather than it pointing towards outside, at least for cold weather? So I haven't used them in winter. I don't tend to camp in winter. The van isn't set up for that. I don't have the heater. And I think there's some misconception that they'll magically warm the van up by bouncing your heat back to you. They are quite a cheap DIY option. They help reducing a bit of condensation, but the reality is that if you want heat, then it's going to be a case of putting a heater in. This product going softer after use many times and I will lose its shape. I think I understand what you're trying to say there, and it is a DIY method. It's not some factory made item. They will change shape a bit, I've no doubt, but they are ideal for helping to reduce condensation and keep the van a bit cooler in summer. Also, if they tear in day-to-day use, you can patch them up with a little bit of foil tape. I always factor in how much time something will take me and how much I earn an hour. So I don't think I'll be attempting to do this. I will instead just buy some. That's totally fair enough. I made these during lockdown. I had so much time on my hands. I could devote a lot of time to it. I can make a video about it and do lots of other work on the van as well. For some people, it will be easier just to buy some. I've personally thought they were quite expensive. Having had some insulation left over, some leftover carpet, I just had to buy some trim for the edges, and then I made my own with my spare time. How did you do the electrics? My electrics in the van are really simple. I personally don't know anything about electrics, so I just went and bought a big battery, which I've built into my table here, and it can power phones, laptop, other devices, and also the LED lights. I've got a folding solar panel, which can help charge it, but also I'll just charge it off the mains or off an electric hookup if we're camping. So for the cool box, which I included in the electrics video originally, I looked at that cooler, but it seems very close to the handbrake. Yeah, it really is. It's a really narrow gap there, but it does fit and it fits quite nicely. I haven't had any problems with knocking the handbrake. That said, I don't have the cool box in the van very often, just when we're camping. I do trust my handbrake, and I think it's unlikely by accessing the cool box, I'd accidentally knock the handbrake off. So now onto the van furniture. Where do you screw the whole structure to the van? Do you screw on the metal of the van? So I've tried to keep my van as removable as possible. I've used turnbuckles for the bed and the storage chest, and for the table, which kind of floats on the wall, I used 5 bolts into screw threads, which were already in the van from the factory. So it's very sturdy on there. I haven't added any extra screws, and that's because I don't want to have to worry about rust in the future. I wanted to know how you match the shelf to the contour of the van so perfectly. So first of all, thank you, but it's far from perfect. But in order to make these, I just got some cardboard, worked out the contours, drew up the contours and cut them to fit, and then copied the cardboard template onto the wood and then cut there, and managed to get a reasonable match from the wood to onto the carpet of the wall. Wasted time, effort, material on the table when a single piece of birch plywood cut to size does the job. Okay. So I completely understand where you're coming from. Unfortunately, I'm not sure the van would fit a complete piece of birch plywood, so it's quite difficult to transport that. I managed to source some cheap bits of pine board. They were already in lengths which needed less cutting. Also, I can't easily source good quality birch ply where I live. So it was just a case of using these pine boards, and it worked an absolute treat. Next up, how much did it cost? Well, I've done a whole video where I've added up the entirety of my van build, so check it out if you're interested. So next up is ventilation, and everyone always says, oh, you haven't got a fan in the roof of the van, but we only sleep in the van less than 30 nights a year, and I really haven't found it yet to be something that I require. Also, I'd have to introduce a bigger battery, a leisure battery, into the van, which I don't quite have the skills for. Maybe that's something for the future, but at the moment I'm sticking with my my small power pack. As the next comment suggests, yes, I just crack the front two windows to circulate a bit of air at night, but with the wind deflectors, no rain gets in. That said, if I lived in the van or camped a lot more, I would definitely consider a fan or a vent, but at the moment it just isn't necessary for the van build. So onto the heating, which I mentioned a little bit earlier. Are you going to fit a diesel heater in the NV200s? I know loads of people fit diesel heaters, and I'm sure they're great, but it's one of those things which would require quite a lot of work and extra money into the van build, and it's just not something that I found I've needed. We don't camp in winter, and in the summer months it's really quite nice in the van. What is the coldest climate you use the van in? So every van should definitely be built to be tailored to the conditions that you intend to use them in. I live in an area of England which doesn't get too hot in the summer and doesn't get too cold in the winter. So rarely above 0 degrees and rarely ever above 30 degrees. So it's a case of the van staying at quite a nice temperature throughout the whole year. So I do have quite a few people say that things are missing from my van build, that I don't have a vent, that I don't have a diesel heater. Completely understand that. Where is your toilet and its setup, and how do you do your shower? Well, I was never gonna install a toilet or a shower in the van. It's about 2 by 1.5 meters inside, so really quite small. It would have been a waste of space to install those things. If it was a bigger van, absolutely, that would be great. And you can even get fold-up toilets, showers that you hang on the back door. But for us, it wouldn't have been necessary. We'd be camping at a campsite, most likely, so we'd have all the facilities there. And that means we can save the space in here for the things we really need, like a comfortable bench or bed, and a table and furniture and storage. So to finish, I really love my van and the van conversion that it holds. It's great to drive, and it also helps that it's fuel efficient, getting about 50 miles to the gallon, that's a UK gallon, and that's just driving to work or out and about on adventures. I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you've got any other questions about my van build or anything really, just leave them in the comments below, and hopefully I can make another video like this soon. Thanks for watching, and if you've enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe.